you know, I referred earlier to the Federal Open Market Committee and the fact that we've had decades of experience in refining our approach to achieving our dual mandate of price stability and maximum employment. By comparison, the Federal Reserve and other financial regulators are in the early stages of crafting a comprehensive approach to fulfilling the mandate of ensuring financial stability. You know, we all recognize that with the passage of the Dodd-Frank Act, Congress has redesigned the financial landscape. Some rules have been implemented, while others have yet to be written. And the Federal Reserve and other regulators are just beginning to navigate this landscape of new laws and new rules on a range of subjects, from capital and liquidity of financial companies to the oversight of non-financial entities that have the potential to destabilize financial markets. Regulators need to finish getting the rules in place, and then they need to demonstrate that they have the ability and the will to use these new tools to address financial system stability. In the meantime, I would urge some patience as we lay the foundation for a comprehensive framework for supporting financial system stability. Going forward, I think the Federal Reserve and other regulators will continue to take steps to improve information transparency and regulatory transparency in order to enhance the stability of the financial system. One way to improve information transparency is through broadening the stress tests that I was talking about. Right now, those stress tests have been conducted on financial firms, but systemically important non-banks will also be subject to the stress test once FSOC determines who those institutions are. So that will be one way of broadening the use of stress tests. Also, stress tests could be broadened to explicitly consider the effects of a bank's stress on its most important counterparties. This would be especially useful if many banks each rely on the same small set of counterparties for certain kinds of transactions, as was the case with AIG and credit default swaps during the most recent financial crisis. Another way to improve information transparency is to provide the public with more information about the quality of bank assets. For example, regulators could require disclosure of material information on a firm's portfolio, the portfolio's risk structure. For example, we could require the firm to disclose the geographic distribution of a firm's loan portfolio. You know, market participants and bank supervisors would likely view the risk of an institution with 90% of its construction loans concentrated in either a depressed area or an overheated real estate market. They would view that differently, or those risks differently, from the risk of an institution that had construction loans spread across a large geographic area across the country. Regulators could also require the disclosure of the distribution of FICO scores in a bank's consumer loan portfolio. By requiring banks to make such disclosures, banking supervisors can promote information transparency on individual firms. These disclosures would also reinforce regulatory transparency related to the actions that regulators will take to address certain portfolio concentrations. So greater regulatory transparency is important and can also result from supervisors and regulators being more forceful and more proactive in carrying out our expanded responsibilities. And this is the expanded responsibilities around financial stability. For example, in 2010, the SEC imposed tougher rules on the money market mutual funds to bolster their solvency. However, some do not think that the steps that the SEC took were sufficient to safeguard financial stability. The Dodd-Frank Act gave the Financial Stability Oversight Council the authority to provide more stringent regulations, and they did so by recommending that the SEC apply a new heightened set of standards or safeguards for the money market mutual funds. And in fact, in an effort to address threats that money market mutual funds can pose to the financial system, the FSOC is considering whether to formally recommend that the SEC proceed with structural reforms of money market mutual funds and has asked for public comments on several options designed to address this issue. So here's an example where one entity, the SEC, had a set of rules in mind, but with Dodd-Frank and the creation of FSOC, there is an additional way to address financial system stability issues. Now, in the interest of full disclosure, I should note that I, along with the other 11 Federal Reserve Bank presidents, co-signed a letter recently in support of FSOC's efforts to address the risks to financial stability that are posed by the money market mutual funds. And regardless of the final resolution on this issue, the fact is that this new process does enable the regulatory community acting as a whole to take actions, again, to ensure financial stability. Yet another way to enhance regulatory transparency is to keep pushing forward in this area of living wills. You know, as I mentioned earlier, the Federal Reserve and the FDIC have published the living wills for the 11 systemically important financial institutions. However, it's not clear to me that market participants have yet reached the point that they trust that living wills, in concert with the bankruptcy code and the Dodd-Frank Act orderly liquidation authority, can be relied upon to safely liquidate a firm in an acute financial stress. Furthermore, even though FSOC has designated 8 financial market utility firms as systemically important, there have not been named any non-bank firms to that list of systemically important institutions, and subsequently none of them have been required to create a living will. So I think that successfully addressing the too big to fail problem requires the establishment of a credible resolution process, one that applies and appears capable of safely managing the failure of systemically important financial institutions in time of distress. Achieving this credibility will, I think, in turn require a fair amount of both information and regulatory transparency. You know, and I know this is not easy work, but the gains from the success are likely to be very substantial. Now, I'd like to end my remarks where I began them, and that is by referring to monetary policy. As a participant on the FOMC, I've learned that transparency practiced consistently does promote accountability, and it's accountability that leads to credibility. Credibility is crucial for financial firms and for supervisors, not just for monetary policy authorities. And credibility accumulates when there is public confidence and market confidence that rules are clear and that they're being followed by the supervisors as well as the financial firms. Access to accurate information about financial firms and about the actions that regulators will take is a key factor in promoting transparency. And I feel strongly that it is going to be transparency that promotes financial stability. In a healthy information environment like the one that I'm describing, both market forces and banking supervisors will have a greater scope to discipline firms. Constructively used, transparency can enhance the ability of supervisors to achieve their goals. You know, over time, as we navigate the new financial services landscape, I hope that the benefits from increased transparency that I have seen at work in the conduct of monetary policy will become increasingly evident as we work to make sure that we have financial stability, and it will be helpful as we develop our financial stability policies. So again, let me thank you for your attendance at this conference, and more importantly, thank you for the work that all of you are doing in very different disciplines to help build this critical framework around financial stability. Congress has given us a challenge, and working together across the regulatory agencies, but also across these various disciplines that are represented here today, I'm confident that we will meet that challenge. So again, thank you for your kind attention and your participation. I look forward to learning from the speakers and discussants and panelists that we're going to have the rest of this day. Thank you very much.